It's massive, it's absolutely gorgeous, and it's iconic too. But it's a 1.7 meter FMS Warbird, so is it actually any good? Hey there, I'm John. This is TwobrosRC, and this is the FMS Tigercat 1700mm. The F7F Tigercat is one of the most unique airframes out there. It's a super skinny, twin-engine fighter that really didn't get to fly for long because it was late to join World War II. If you've seen our reviews on previous FMS Warbirds in this class, the one defining characteristic of all FMS Warbirds of this scale is that they lack thrust. So let's break from tradition and actually cover flight time and agility first, because this Warbird is unlike any of the other FMS 1700s. Today I'll be covering the following metrics that apply to 1.5 meter and larger Warbirds: landing gear, flight time, agility, fit and finish, and avionics and lighting. Starting off with flight time, if you enjoy long flights, you will get them with this plane. You can easily achieve 7 minutes of flight even on a 4400 battery. Throttle management is key, but a lightweight SMC 4400 battery will get you there and then some. Hell, even on my last flight for this year in review, I got 9 minutes and 30 seconds on a 4400 and I wasn't being gentle with it either. These SMC batteries are no joke. There's a reason why Danny frequently sells out of them.
That thing just sounds so cool, man.
That reason, of course, is that they make planes like this fly even better than they do out of the box.
So here's some stall testing with it. We're gonna go power off, pulling full back elevator. I'm just steering with it with rudder right now. It's just kind of going, like, it's literally just full back elevator. Took a while for it to finally drop a wing, and it didn't even do it severely at all. Let's try it power on. Probably not a bright move because we're like halfway through or mostly through this battery, but it don't matter. I gotta show this off. Okay, pull the stick back. Okay, so this plane can Harrier. That's cute. I don't think it stalls power on as long as you're not like really going fast. Let's try again. I'm gonna try steering it with rudder now. Oh, wow, that's a really, really touchy rudder. Okay, it goes right into a hover. Okay, so that's curious. Normally you don't see that kind of behavior with a plane. I'm pretty sure I could do a Harrier pass with this plane. Let's get the gear up and let's see if a Warbird can do a high alpha pass, which I think it can. We've already demonstrated in the last pack that it can do it, but this is goofy. I can't believe I'm doing this. It does get a little wing rocky if you get the angle of attack too high up, but if you don't, it stays put. Here's the real test. Can we turn it like this? Oh, this is stupid. We can do it. Oh my God, look at this. It's like a 3D plane. I guess it makes sense. It's a big kite. Yeah, we got more than enough power to wait. More than enough. If you were thinking that we didn't have enough, nah, you got plenty. I know this Warbird's gonna hit every criteria for agility in the Warbird category for the metrics that we've got. It does everything that I tell it to do. It is the most agile 1700 millimeter Warbird that FMS makes, which makes no sense because it's so big and heavy. But yet, look at it go. Look at it go. That you can do a Harrier pass with something that weighs like 10 pounds. Overall, no, I love this thing. I can't believe I'm able to get it to do Harrier passes like this. I know the purists out there that are watching a Warbird video are freaking out watching me do this, but it's a foam plane. It's real, but it's foam, and it's not a full-scale aircraft. So it's cool to see what these planes can do, that the planform allows it to do. Here it comes. Like, look at how controllable this is. This shouldn't be possible with a Warbird, I would think, but yet here we are. See if we can, like, watch behind the reeds there. See it?
Yeah.
That's so cool. Some of that could be prop wash too, but you can actually see like a line that it makes. It's really excellent in slow speed flight, more than I thought it would be. Now here's the ultimate test. Let's see what it does when the flaps are dropped. Okay, flaps are out. Hopefully it doesn't go crazy. Actually, it seems like it... Are you kidding me? It's staying put with the flaps. It's not dropping a wing. Normally when you drop flaps, you're increasing the... Nope, there it goes. Okay, it took a moment. When you drop flaps, normally the critical angle of attack will go down. Not even normally. That's just how aerodynamics works. The critical angle of attack goes down, meaning the... it reduces it. So in other words, you can't hold the nose up as much with flaps dropped, otherwise the plane stalls earlier. But you get the ability to fly slower with the nose at a lower angle like this. So with the plane flap, with the flaps dropped like this going in a straight line, I'm able to go slower at a consequence of drag with additional lift. But if I raise the nose too much, most planes will drop a wing violently. But this one doesn't. It took quite a while, like full 10, 15 seconds of being up in the air messing with it to do that. This is a very surprising airframe. It's very cool to see what aerodynamics can do in action. And this is kind of why I'm saying it's a pretty good beginner's warbird. If you can ignore the price tag, if that's not a factor to you, then you should have no problem with it at all. Absolutely, like the handling is absurdly good. The slow speed flight characteristics, the fact that you can hold it in a Harrier pass, or more accurately, a high alpha pass, but still, the fact that you can do that with such a big, heavy airplane due to the wing's planform and the overall design of the plane speaks volumes about how well designed this airplane is. Oh, so it just really, really, it looks cool.
It looks amazing.
Let's just hover it for a minute and see if we can do that. I stand by my statement that this is the best warbird, in my opinion, in the 1700mm line from FMS. This thing is so agile, so fast, so good, and honestly, it just flies so good. It's hard to imagine that it's in the same class as some of the other planes from FMS in this scale, where they feel like dogs in the sky and they don't have the same level of agility or airspeed or anything else. Let's get a full speed pass going down this runway to show you what it's really capable of. Good God, that's almost scary.
Scary good.
I'm very confident that this is the most beginner-friendly warbird out there. It definitely is not the most inexpensive, obviously, but it's very friendly to anyone who wants to get into warbirds. Most warbirds are tail draggers and require solid stick and rudder skills. The Tigercat is a tricycle-geared plane and does not require that expertise at all. It certainly benefits from it, but it isn't mandatory. It takes off and lands like a dream too, naturally moving us along to the landing gear portion of today's review. The landing gear would be a 5 out of 5 if not for the fact that there are 3 out of 5. The hard plastic wheels continue to dog FMS models and drag them down one point. I'm sure that there's replacements that you can find which will be a significant upgrade over the stock plastic foam wheels. The gear system itself, however, is an absolute work of art with an insane level of detail. I can't believe that this level of quality is featured in a model aircraft of this size. They really know how to make some well-designed gear systems. However, I really struggled with whether or not I should include the footage of only one gear dropping.
I think my favorite thing to do with this plane is touch and goes. It's so awesome at it. And honestly, like, the way this thing flies, it's pretty beginner to warbird friendly because it's a tricycle geared warbird. There's no P factor to worry about. It does have really robust gear. You keep a little bit of throttle on the approach and you can butter them in like this. The wheels do sound kind of rough, but they're not too bad once you wear them in a little bit. Still, I'm going to call that a ding on my criteria for warbirds because, again, it should have rubber tires. If you're going to put all that weight into this plane, you might as well put it into a place where it actually makes a huge difference. I only see one wheel coming out. So sometimes you got to let the wheels do their thing, cycle all the way back up before you try to drop them again. Otherwise, they make it one of them really drops and the rest of them don't. Now the next cycle starts. Shouldn't see all three coming out.
This only happens if you're cycling the gear in flight too quickly while throttle is applied. It's a servo power issue. But then I realized it's not really a review if I'm not including my experiences, so I had to ding it on the flawless gear operation. While it did work perfect almost every single time, that one time was enough for it to not qualify here. I'm not gonna run interference for any company. If I have an issue that's not my own stupidity causing it, then I've gotta include it in the review so that you have the information you need to make a decision on whether this plane is right for you. Moving on to the fit and finish, FMS gets the paint and finish flawless, but the raised rivets cause the stickers to have issues with, well, sticking. Not much of a sticker if it can't stick, innit? I also don't like that the stickers cover up all of the fantastic model detail. Why go through all the effort of including gorgeous amounts of riveted foam detail only for solid colored stickers to hide it? FMS, come on, let's start moving on to water slide decals. I know that they're a pain to apply, but they look so much better. In terms of avionics and lighting, the servos are not fast, but they are strong and they're metal. All of the servos in this plane are undoubtedly up to the task of hauling this big-ass fighter through the sky. If you strip one of these or damage them, I'll be shocked. The ESCs also handle the load of the twin motors with no heating issues that I could see, even on a hot June afternoon. The lighting is very well done, and the motor mounts appear to be acceptable too.
See if we can flat spin it. I doubt we can. Anything but flat.
Yeah.
On to the final tally. Let's compare what I said last year to the overall score today.
My opinion on this is that this plane is a solid 10 out of 10.
Wrong again, John. This plane is actually a 21 out of 25. A year later, if we were still going by my gut feeling, I would call it a 10 out of 10. But we're not using a gut feeling system anymore. 21 out of 25 is still very respectable scoring overall. Some of the issues that I care about may be issues that you don't care about. Maybe you care less about stickers and decals and more about how it flies, in which case you're definitely going to love this plane because it flies better than any other 1700mm FMS Warbird. It is heavier than the Corsair or the Mustang, but it has nearly 50% more thrust and it can be flown super slow or very fast.
Now I remember why I like this one.
Because it's so big?
It's like a monster in the sky. It's freaking amazing.
I love it. Yeah, it's beautiful. Let's get a nice close pass in the wind.
I'm telling you, this is an absurdly good Warbird. There are a couple of issues with it that I don't like. Again, the hard tires are a bit of an issue, but they do have a little bit of bounce to them. Unfortunately, or not bounce, but squeezability, whatever you want to call it, the softness. But that's only after you've flown them off pavement enough to rough them up to get them to that point. So if you zoom in on the wheels a little bit, you'll see what I'm talking about. This is a heavy plane too. It takes a lot of space. It does have a little bit of shock absorption, but it is overall the best Warbird, in my opinion, that FMS sells in this class, the 1700mm class. Unless you really love Mustangs, or unless you really love Corsairs, this thing blows them away. It is the presence to it, the feel, the agility, everything about it, the fit and finish. There's very little I don't like aside from the stickers and the tail that you put on the plane. I don't like stickers. I don't understand why we couldn't have had decals like the lovely lady in the front here. Whereas the rest of it had to be stickers that are, because of all these rivets on the skin, they don't stick as well as they could otherwise. But beyond that, that's really the biggest issue I've got with this plane. It is almost perfect. It is so good in every way that it's possible to be good, except for a couple of tiny little problems. Definitely consider picking one of these up. Link is in the description. Use the codes referral TwobrosRC for 10% off your first order, or TwobrosRC for $10 off $100 or more. Will save you a little bit of cash in this plane for sure, especially since it's not one of the cheapest ones they sell, but you are getting what you pay for with this plane, absolutely 100%. Thanks for watching, guys.